Hello, everyone. My name is Jessica Kennedy, and I'm the educator for adult learning at the St. Louis Art Museum. Thank you so much for joining us for today's artist talk with Oscar Murillo. Before we begin, please familiarize yourself with the Q&A section located on your screen. Feel free to enter your questions at any time during the program, and we will choose a few to answer at the end. Also, there is live auto transcription available for this program. Please click the CC icon to activate or deactivate the subtitles. We would also like to thank the Trio Foundation of St. Louis for the grant support of Currents 121, Oscar Murillo. To get us started and to introduce our speaker, I will turn things over to Hannah Klemm, the Associate Curator of Modern and Contemporary Art. Thanks so much, Hannah.
Thanks, Jessica. It's my absolute pleasure to be here with Oscar Murillo and to get to introduce him to you all virtually. Oscar Murillo is an internationally celebrated artist who has an MFA from the Royal College of Art in London. He has exhibited all over the world, and honestly, if I were to sit here and name all the exhibitions, we would take up the whole hour, so I'll only name a few. Most recently, including Oscar Murillo's Spirits and Gestures at the Fondazione Memo in Rome, a two-person exhibition, Collision Coalition, at the Shed in New York City, and Social Altitude at the Aspen Art Museum. And most recently, Currents 121 at the St. Louis Art Museum, which opens today and runs through August 28th. In addition to all of the exhibitions and the art practices, Oscar is also the co-founder with political scientist Clara DuBlanc of the nonprofit Frequencies Foundation that works with schools and school-aged children around the world, which we'll talk about a little bit in this conversation. So welcome, Oscar.
Anna, thank you. It's a pleasure to be back in this incredible museum with such a historical, encyclopedic collection of art, and not only, of course, the pleasure to exhibit my work, you know, these paintings that, you know, are holding these gallery spaces, but I think equally important Frequencies to bring it here, to see it amongst the collection. I think that has been something special to witness this morning. And I think in a way that mirrors the conversation we'll have in relation to some of the projects and perhaps the reason why I decided or you know, suggested that we start or we engage through some of my work, not through painting, but through projects that maybe have hinted at concerns in relation to, you know, a kind of socio-political, maybe is the right word. I don't want to use that word lightly, you know, in reference to who I am, where I come from, how to deal with maybe shifts and changes that are happening in society that I, you know, I am engaged in, that I am interested in. Naturally, Frequencies, a project that has taken us, you know, my colleagues, Clara, you know, my parents who have been heavily involved in implementing and working with different communities around the world. So, and then to obviously kind of complete or to arrive at these paintings that maybe particularly in the context of the collection, particularly in the context of American contemporary and also modern history, might mean something differently. Or not, but you know, it becomes a kind of conversation, maybe.
Yeah, it's incredibly interesting to think about social practice and this kind of reified, very white walls art history, and how to really kind of create these connections and draw people's attention to the fact that art isn't created in a vacuum and that the world doesn't exist separate from art. And I think that's something that's so interesting about your practice, is not only is it constantly connected to life, it's also incredibly multifaceted and multidimensional, and really considers what different mediums are needed to say different things or to exist in different spaces. So maybe that's a way that we can start. The show here is paintings outside of this intervention of the Frequencies project, but your work isn't only paintings. You have sculptural practice, performance practice, video practice. Maybe starting at the beginning as to how these different elements connect for you and how you see them working. You've used the term porous before, a very porous practice.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, starting with you know, hopefully all the audiences can see this picture. This picture, it precedes the Mercantile novel in 2014 at David's Werner, which was my first show in New York. And I was kind of, in a way, you know, I think I chose this picture because it kind of highlights maybe a lot of tensions in relation to, you know, the historical colonial labor exploitation, and, you know, coming or growing up in a plantation culture in Colombia, and, you know, still very much the case, you know, it's not, we have not developed or have moved on to a kind of a more complex social structure. It's very simple. You work, you go to the factory. And then, of course, you know, I moved to London, and then, but I am constantly connected. Some of the people in this picture are friends of mine. And the Mercantile novel, it's a little bit like, you know, coming to New York, which is by far, in a contemporary context, the epicenter of commerce, consumption, generally speaking. And in a way, mercantile is a, you know, comes from a 19th century word. It speaks of the past, it speaks of history, which ironically then brings in, you know, the Midwest, you know, like as a kind of industrial, you know, the industrial heart of modernity, you know, is in this region. And for me, it was interesting that I wanted to approach this exhibition in New York back in 2014, not necessarily with, you know, I wanted to bring in a kind of the armature of who I am, trying to negotiate that with, you know, perhaps biography, perhaps also something that is maybe critical, being super aware that, you know, David's Werner Gallery is a successful, very successful commercial enterprise, and how the two operate, you know, these two systems, you know, operate, you know, next to each other. Also the idea of voyeurism too, and kind of then, you know, the placing myself kind of in the center of that. So I think the show wasn't necessarily about art. I think it was maybe an inquiry, mm-hmm. an inquiry that I was suggesting in relation to myself, in relation to where I was in life. So I think it's something that is, I very often say, I think it's an exhibition that is not concluded, or a show or a situation that has yet to be concluded. And this picture in a way says a lot about, you know, that this kind of golden, you know, bust of the founder of this factory 100 years ago. And then you have this kind of rainbow of people, you know, in a Latin American context. So, and I think that it is enough. This picture is enough. That then, therefore, I do not want to get into anything else. You know, I think it's, I want to leave it open and alive, so to not close the possibilities of how the reading can then be determined by, you know, by different people. And I think then, you know, this then jumps, and then we can talk about that after, but then this, you know, from 2014, you know, that's a good 8 years, and then that then, you know, takes us to the show now, and then of course I will elaborate on the show as to how, you know, what is the truth beneath this picture, I think, is in the show.
Oh, wow.
You know, the from not, you know, from not, I think, if there is anger, anxiety, you know, oppression, how does that get out?
Mm-hmm.
You know, how does that kind of manifest itself? You know, hence the title of this kind of works, manifestations. You know, how do you manifest, how, you know, music, as you know, like throughout oppression, you know, it has been historically an important vehicle in different cultures, you know, not just in notions of being Afro, but music, it's you know, to it almost act as a kind of shield to protect yourself.
Mm-hmm.
So then that's, you know, that's maybe why I thought it was important to, or necessary to start with this moment, also the you know, and so then that's kind of, yeah, like he grounds this conversation maybe.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's interesting to think about the starting point being this kind of group of people, this gesture, this thought about society and labor, and then end with paintings. But those paintings, hopefully, in this arc, are also going to exhibit those same gestures, and that we get to see kind of those interconnected notions, that we don't exist in a world where labor is in a single mm-hmm. space or vacuum, or that we don't exist in a world where the what is produced doesn't have somebody who's a maker in any mm-hmm. context. Should we go to the next slide?
Yes, absolutely.
So these are images from a very recent exhibition from 2019. So jumping, I guess, 7 years,
yeah.
My math is at all correct. And again, if we start with this video, do I have to hit something? There we go. Video, getting the tech right. Again, shows this performative element. And you know, I'd love for you to talk about the sculptures, but also the performance, and how you think about these different objects working within your broader practice and within the context of how we're building up to this show of paintings.
Yeah, I mean, again, it's, you know, this is New York, this is Fifth Avenue approaching the Rockefeller Center. You know, from a historical perspective, this video as a kind of symbol of this procession from Hell's Kitchen, from Hudson Yards, from this new development, from notions of power, of you know, the shed, this institution, this new institution in New York, representing in terms of how did it come about. It's the epitome of, in a way, gentrification, but also gentrification in relation to, you know, to power and consumption. You know, really, particularly before the pandemic, you know, really kind of the world is really driving, you know, spearheading quickly and very ferociously towards, you know, and a future that obviously is not what we have now, but, and in a way, what was the shadow of that? The shadow of that, in a way, historically, you know, is perhaps one can propose the Rockefeller, you know, as this kind of foundation power. And then I think about art and culture, I think about Diego Rivera as this kind of artist that signaled the breakaway, this kind of unreconcilable, in a way, ideals, you know, a kind of socialist, the world that notions of equality. And then, of course, there was a beautiful show at the Whitney Americana, you know, which really then, from an arts perspective, really gave you this beautiful reading, you know, of like how muralism and the influence of muralism in abstraction in artists, you know, like Gaston and so on. And for me, it was this effigies that in a Colombian culture are used as a kind of folklorish omen of sorts to rid of bad spirits, to end the year and to kind of, you know, draw a new line of hope and renewal. I kind of stole them and began to bring them into my work as labors, as representation of workers, you know, from you know, workers from all shades and sizes and places. And I wanted to bring them, you know, they literally, before that moment, they had gone as far and wide as China, obviously Latin America, Europe. We went to North Africa, Johannesburg. And the whole idea was to conclude this project by bringing them to this kind of very specific building that has this history, and to, in a way, salute or do a bit of an homage to Diego Rivera. And in a way, maybe mirrors a little bit my thoughts around the Mercantile novel. I think there are kind of similarities, but I think it gets closer, ironically, to then thinking what do these large paintings mean and represent to me. And I actually, in a very maybe crazy way, I see those paintings closer to maybe kind of 1920s murals, you know, Mexican muralism. There's no representation. Mm-hmm. I think that there are all these avenues that I am investigating, that there is, of course, a kind of desire, you know, you have a project like Frequencies that in collaboration with Clara DuBlanc, who's a social scientist, that I remove myself because I am aware of my limits, and I do not want to take responsibility for the collaboration and what entails to work with young people. But I think from a symbolic place, you have a project that in the space of a decade, more or less, has reached, you know, hundreds and thousands of kids. Not that there is a kind of direct introduction, but I think the offering of a canvas on a desk as a kind of space of possibility, as an intimate space of conscious and unconscious mark making, is possibly the biggest, you know, social, you know, practice or the social kind of awareness that I want to have. And then if, of course, we see there as a successful thing, then what do these paint? So for whom are these paintings?
Yeah. You know,
for whom are these large scale paintings that we have in these galleries? And what do you do with that space? You know, what do you do with that? You know, why do they have to be that big? And I think it is then that I think about all that kind of oppression, and I think about all the kind of complications of how do you get rid of that energy? How do you get rid of, you know, that kind of anxiety? How do you get rid of, you know, almost through being channeled through history as a kind of vessel? How do you then engulf those spaces? And I think it was very important, this idea of engulfing, or, you know, very often as I was planning the exhibition, it was very important to me that I wanted to engulf the viewer, because it it's not really about painting, it's about an energy and a spirit, and making sure that the moment you enter those galleries that you do not escape, and that you maybe go in a journey with me and transcend a little bit. So in a way, the idea of like format, or also formalities, and how I make this work, it isn't, and not that there is a way or a given kind of formula, but it's really about almost a kind of, you know, is it catharsis or exorcism, in which all these kind of references to gestures that are much more, in a way, conceptually based or guided by history, almost like footnotes in an essay, that the meat of it, and that ultimately the viscera, you know, is the thing that is sitting in the middle. So in a way, the paintings are literally kind of this viscera that's kind of vibrating, being held by this kind of coordinates in a way. And that's what I thought it was important to kind of make references to this, to kind of maybe allow the viewer or the person, the people maybe in this conversation with us, to maybe understand a little bit. It's definitely not a formal conversation about the history, you know, of abstraction, or, and then, you know, and then in that exercise, he also brings to mind the show that Oakley and Wenzel curated at House de Kunst. I think it was in 2000, and I think it was 2016, 17, I can't remember. It was called Post-War, you know, where he kind of beautifully, you know, deconstructs a linear interpretation of what, you know, using or bringing in samples from different parts of the world, and perhaps in my own, you know, using my own history and my own kind of, you know, complications, I am drawing into different modes, so that I shield also, you know, more and more, I think, how the you know, my work, or how the, or the, at least the intention, you know, like I don't want to control anything, but at least the intention, and absolutely, you know, even though the exhibition was postponed because of the pandemic, it was nevertheless a breakthrough moment in really to allow these paintings to exist. I think before then they were like, I think that the coordinates were not so clear, you know. I think, you know, 10 years ago I would write, you know, a word maybe like burrito, or, you know, that maybe I was trying to maybe everything was like, you know, too contaminated, and maybe that's okay, you know, for the time. It was absolutely okay. But now, like, having the ability to distill the purity of how to withdraw and manifest that energy and the intention and that oppression, then things become clearer somehow.
Yeah, that's really interesting to think about how the paintings exist, like, as this manifestation of these nexuses of energy. Mm-hmm. And I think let's move and maybe see some, to give some visual context to the paintings. But one of the things that's so amazing about the performance in relation to how you're talking about the paintings is the performance, the effigy, sometimes the conceptual framework may be more legible in a traditional conceptual art sense, But I love how you explain this as actually having the same energy in a certain context or an expanded energy that allows for the paintings to function in a way that exists beyond traditional narratives of Western art or all of the kind of static codes in which we read paintings by, that without this, it's harder to pick up on why there's an incredibly different feeling in a room of your paintings than thinking necessarily just about abstraction in general, because it is this cathartic release. There is energy being put onto the viewer that comes out of the fact that it exists within this incredible nexus of a conceptual framework that considers globalized systems of labor, movement of people and histories, that there's an embedded context within why this energy is put to canvas in this way. So here's this is another view from the shed. And there were paintings as well as the performance. And is that a frequencies canvas, Hank?
No, this is a drawing, which is one of,
we've got a prop.
One of which is the fly drawings. And the fly drawings, I think it was another way to, I think prior to the pandemic, it was another way. And I think it was, I mean, this is all interesting in relation to time and how, you know, prior to the pandemic, the a lot of the engagements, such as the invitation, you know, by my friend Emma Enderby, who curated the show at the Shed, and many other projects, you know, biennials and so on and so forth, that they served more as kind of exercises. They served as a kind of, as a space to experiment, to kind of offer, to try. And then these drawings, the fly drawings, were this kind of, you know, I very often use the word stolen time or stealing time, in which in a flight, in this kind of idle space, I mean, not so idle anymore because you can use the internet, but, you know, back then there was this kind of idea of the flight as an idle space, the vacuum, and then how, again, that there was this constant desire to manifest and to, you know, to kind of spell energy, and there were this, you know, frenetic or these invocations of words, or, you know, repetition of letters that then became kind of non-legible anymore. And then in the context of the show at the Shed, it was that you know placing, you know, kind of suspending this drawing, these drawings, almost like seeing the spans of the gallery as a kind of terrain, almost like a map, maybe, perhaps. And actually, earlier, when I first arrived in the galleries here at the museum, and, you know, I was having conversations about the paintings, and the scale, of course, is something that is overwhelming. But also, people asked, you know, how was your body relation? You know, how do you make decisions? And I said, well, it's actually like making the paintings, it's like the body becomes a compass. And then that takes you into a totally different space, a mind space that is not about formality or gauging formalities, but is about how does the energy and how does the spirit move and navigate that space, and then the body, which is a vessel, then becomes a kind of compass, and there is this kind of physical activity in which you render and you move and you render a painting, you know, complete, totally removing yourself from this energy. So I think, you know, again, and this obviously definitely does get closer to material, you know, it gets closer to, you know, we have these heavy canvases, in a way shrouding the space, in a, you know, the canvas at the far end with this kind of gesture mimicking maybe water alludes a little bit to this idea of, you know, terrain, you know, almost in you know, thinking, you know, the show as this kind of, you know, map in a way, you know, shrouded in darkness. Darkness is a kind of spirit that is not necessarily negative, but it does kind of shake a little bit your body in relation to that space. And so then it is a physical and kind of cerebral engagement.
Yeah. I think there might be a few more images. Yeah, here you can see how those hanging canvases produce such a atmospheric effect on the side too. So we've used the term, so here, so do you want to show, you want to hold it
oh,
up?
Oh, the drawing?
Some more of the airplane.
Yeah, of course, there's the flight drawing.
So it's the most recent one.
It's with carbon paper and, you know, viro and graphite. And so, on the plane, you sit on the, you know, the table, and then, of course, the carbon paper kind of goes in between, you fold, and that's why it has so many folds. And the paper, in a way, and this is something interesting also in relation to the paintings, that the paper is this very strong Japanese paper where the paper becomes a skin, you know. So I'm not really interested, and this is not really, I'm not interested in, like, I like folding it and just putting it in my bag, where the In the way the paintings, this manifestation body of work, are produced, they're produced in a similar way where it's really about charging the canvas, you know, like almost like literally in this idea of you know, removing from me, but also then making sure that the energy is this transfer of energy. I mean, quite literally.
Yeah.
I think that the way even I make paintings is not even about painting, you know, as a kind of, you know, historical, but it's painting as a kind of tool, as a vessel, so that energy can get somewhere else.
Right. Yeah.
You know.
There you can see the canvas that has the kind of watery marks a little clearer. So were these works from the manifestation series?
Yeah. So this is the, I mean, it's interesting to see these paintings now because it, you know, these paintings happened around 2000 and, you know, late 18, 19, in preparation for the show that took place in the summer of 19. So late 18, I was kind of in the studio. And, you know, this kind of ideas of manifestation, I think at the time it was more of a cerebral idea. And that, of course, maybe the scale begins to indicate where is it that I want to go, maybe what the intention is. I think that, you know, there's a slight attempt to maybe be true to that energy and that spirit. I think there's a failure, definitely, at least from giving myself that space, knowing what I know now in relation to the show that we have here. There's definitely a failure because, you know, here I am, you know, traveling, moving, thinking about, you know, the procession in relation to, you know, scale and history. So I think that I think there's too much going on. You know, and then of course the paintings, you know, they take place in the studio, and then you're kind of with all that, you're trying to make, you know, these paintings, I am satisfied with them, but I think the failure comes when, you know, what was that energy relation? And absolutely, at the time, I think that a lot of the things that are consolidated now were not. Mm-hmm. I think the pandemic, with respect to everybody else and to many people, you know, listening to this, the pandemic was one of the most fruitful moments for my career as an artist. Because I think the collapse of movement, the collapse of time, meant that there was nothing else but to just dive into myself. You know, there was no travel, there was no, as you know, exhibitions to organize. But I was just thinking about myself. You know, and I found myself in a very small community, and we will talk about that. But I think for the first time, it allowed me to have a more honest relationship with making these manifestation paintings. That it became much more honest, you know, and, you know, I then naturally demanded more of myself, and I was able to enter a totally different space.
So when you started manifestation in 2018 and then the pandemic hit in 2020, did you consciously think about wanting to continue that series, that it was part of your thought process at that time, that it wasn't complete and that you had more?
No, I think there was a doubt. You know, I think when I came to this show, I thought, oh, you know, this is kind of okay. You know, this is, we leave it here. And you know, it's like, and then of course you can continue to make and like explore other things in relation to mark making, in relation to why, you know, why stick to the same, you know, like range of colors, and you know, you can really then move to a different trajectory, and that's okay, and maybe that will happen later on, you know. But I think the moment the pandemic happens and you're kind of limited to possibility of diversity, and diversity, sometimes what it does, it dilutes. And I think it's, you know, this desire to always be on that I have, this relentlessness, you know, has created this huge foundation for me that I'm glad that it's there. But I think it is just the kind of foundation that hasn't really been built upon. And the pandemic gave me 2 years of just simply, you know, just myself and the studio, and you know, being in Colombia, you know, let's say not so much stuck, but making the choice to stay in Colombia during the pandemic, and being in a place where you're kind of not preoccupied with, you know, your life as an artist, it was the first time that I really then just, you know, like, you know, delved into this abyss. Mm-hmm. And I produced a body of work that I think, not even just in the, from a visual sense, but definitely from, you know, the meaning and what it means, that it was much more powerful, that it was not like on the surface, but it was much more visceral and physical. And I think this three paintings here is the beginning of that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, do you want to talk about this show a little in relation to that progression, or should we?
Yeah, no, I think this show, it's, you know, again, in the spirit of, you know, I almost saw it, you know, here you are in the middle of the pandemic, everything is closed down, you know, in these small towns in many parts of the country, religion or the church becomes a kind of beacon of order, of, you know, of leadership, And it wasn't any different from where I grew up, where the church, then people look up to the priest, people look up to, you know, in terms of like, you know, survival, quite literally. And I became an ally to that, you know, and that I am critical of religion, but I think, you know, this is about humanity. And then, you know, all of a sudden it's not so clear anymore. Like your critical kind of position is not so clear anymore, because it's not about structures, it's just about people. Mm-hmm. And with the priest, I asked if I could do a show in the church. And then it takes me back to those, you know, 10 years ago when I was in this very like unconscious way, writing words like chorizo mm-hmm. in paintings, because in a way, I was using those words and you know, there's always this idea of the shield, you know, or like protection, mm-hmm. you know, like, so I am interested in art making. I am interested in this energy. What does this energy mean? You know, what did this energy meant, spelling that energy? I know what it means now, but I think at the time it was just me knowing that the body was my tool. Mm-hmm. Also in relation to like my identity, you know, this is who I am. And I think that the words in a way further kind of instill that idea, you know, chorizo, burrito, or, you know, all these kind of like, and some, you know, words that are related to food as a kind of, you know, the food, you know, you draw the line and in a kind of gesture of positivity, the food is there as a kind of offer, you know, in a cultural sense. Whether you're Italian, whether you're Chinese, whether you're, you know, food is always this kind of portal of kind of engagement, yeah. And exploration. And in a way, the pandemic took me back to that, but from a negative point of view of austerity, of people not being able to work, people, in a way, not having food. Like, I mean, it's just very simple ideas. Mm-hmm. And then the church becomes the host. No, the mm-hmm. church is this kind of problematic space. And then, in a way, you know, with my friends, we put up this show, and it's there for a month and a bit. And it was almost as if I had, you know, been invited into X place to respond or to kind of do, you know, what usually you do in a banyo, you know, where you right. kind of respond to your kind of, and it just happens that this is the community where I was, you know, I grew up into it. So it was definitely an interesting, not negotiation, because it was quite natural, mm-hmm. but I would say definitely a quite intuitive response to the moment.
It's so interesting how it changes when there's people in the space.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thinking about that actual interaction and the architecture and mm-hmm. the symbols that exist always in the church, and then juxtaposing it with the paintings. Mm. So maybe for the last few minutes we can delve into the manifestation series.
Yeah.
We've been using the word a lot, and the reason is that all the paintings in the St. Louis Museum exhibition are from the manifestation series. So can you just maybe give a little background on why you chose the word manifestation, or how it sort of, we talked about it with the shed, how it came to be, but how does it extend into where it is now?
Yeah, I mean, it starts with the manifestation, I think, almost again as a cerebral idea, as an idea of like, you know, almost wordplay. So, you know, manifestation as a protest, mm-hmm. as a procession, as a kind of, you know, particularly like in certain, you know, languages. And then, of course, you know, there's this idea of the body, you know, like manifesting itself. And the painting that we see here was this was the first painting. It was the first painting in which I'm negotiating, the repetition of letters, the repetition of words in relation to the flight drawings, as a kind of continuum of writing, which again is very external and kind of cerebral and aware of itself, and almost as a kind of and that's when I say cerebral, it's a kind of too aware communication strategy that is complicated and problematic. I think it worked really well with the, it worked tremendously well with the, with the paintings where I think there was an unconscious thing there. You know, when I wrote Burrito or Chorizo, I think it was something very clear. Mm-hmm. And here I'm kind of, dancing, trying to understand that. And then as we saw some examples of those paintings at the shed, and then eventually coming, here to the show, and that kind of transition that has taken place, or that journey, more than a transition, that has occurred, since 2018, is that I am aware of where that energy is coming from. Mm-hmm. And to begin to trust it. And so manifestation then becomes more physical and more about the body. It does not undermine the importance of the symbolic representation of these words, mm-hmm. but the symbolic representation of these words are then now dealt with differently. Because it is actually, if we're talking about manifestation, then it's actually, we're talking about violence and oppression that ultimately is within the body and that ultimately is within the spirit. And that very often, like I say, then nothing else needs to be said. Mm-hmm. And that you have to trust that. You have to trust that energy because it's real. And that's where I talked about failure, is that it's not so much the painting as a successful formal
right.
device, but how true was that journey?
Interesting.
And I think maybe ultimately it does kind of, they marry each other, formality. And I think this is true in relation to my, we can also sit here and talk about, the migration of Europeans into the development of American abstraction, at various points, throughout history.
Yeah.
We know almost the collection in this museum comes from that, So that's not to say that I do not have that awareness, but I think, how can I be honest to myself in relation to the work that I make, so that even if the audience decide to ignore it, I know for myself where is it placed, where is the core of it, in order so that I can continue to explore. That space.
Yeah, no, that's really interesting. Do you think, in terms of how language functions in the manifestation series versus the earlier paintings, where there was a very visible and kind of semiotic relationship between the word on the canvas, do you see these in terms of some kind of an erasure or obfuscation, or is it much more that the energy is just layered and therefore it's embedded within the various gestures, but not necessarily eradicated or obscured?
I think it's that. I think it's I think it's it's precisely what I'm saying. It's allowing trust in that energy to be much more powerful, mm-hmm. To be much more sincere and to transcend, the representation of language itself.
That's right. Yeah. Here you can see where a word has been gestured upon. Mm.
has been acted upon.
Acted upon. I don't know where the last, oh shoot. Hey, behind the scenes tech folks, could we pull up those three slides that have some images of the St. Louis show, and maybe we'll spend the last 5 minutes bringing it all together?
Yeah, we kind of bring it,
And for those of you who can come see the show, it's a really amazing experience to be in the galleries. And hopefully these images, if we can find them, will kind of showcase that scale. Jessica, do you? I'm looking for the three slam images you added. Oh, the front. Okay, perfect, thanks. That's perfect. Wait till it goes full screen. Sorry, there's always gotta be a tech issue on a Zoom, right? So this is, from the show before it even opened. One of the things that I found as a curator so interesting in our discussions of the show is you were the first artist I've worked with in these spaces that ever spanned the two galleries with a painting. So can you talk a little bit about, maybe we'll just kind of, we don't even have to talk anything specific about a work, but maybe we can bring it together and see how you saw the manifestation paintings in this exhibition that you finished fairly recently in the scheme of things.
Yeah.
Fitting into those kind of narratives of energy and bodily relations to both history and space and art. How do you see them kind of coming together in the show in this moment?
Well, I mean, I think it was, I mean, they all kind of come, they all work. So like it was about, the strategy of installing the show, but also the desire to think about installation and not painting. And, to think about, again, energy and the body, formality and not. The definitely the, every single painting in that show, in this show here, was thought for the space. And trusting, almost for the first time, that is enough. And I think it's part of this journey, almost transcending out of this idea that I am not grateful that I made those experiments, where you bring this kind of, this apparatus, this kind of shield. And I think the shield very often function as a kind of, as an added layer. I'm not against it, and I'm not saying I'm done with it, but I think, again, history and I've always, since the beginning, since even picking up a canvas, why even pick up a canvas? Why do you want to choose that vessel as a vessel of communication, knowing how charged, knowing its history? And the moment I made those conscious decisions, I said, well, if I am going to use this vessel, it has to be the best. It has to be the best linen. It has to be the best oil paints. Even though money was an issue at the time, buying paints is expensive. So how, so then even making those word paintings that I, crudely scribbled, a word like chorizo, was done in the awareness of economics, or the lack of ability, but always with truth, saying I want to buy the best oil paints. And then I think, for the first time in relation to history, the beauty of this museum is that it has this incredible, and as we walked earlier through the galleries, you know, its relationship to, you know, German painting is you know, it doesn't get better. So then almost for the first time, that entire kind of projection or that kind of system that I'm kind of working to build has the ability to perform, you know, purely. And it would have been a mistake to pretend that you're going to tackle that history with all this kind of apparatus, mm-hmm. you know. Because if you, as you navigate those two spaces, you're surrounded by Richter, you're surrounded by, you know, Mitchell, and you're surrounded by these titans of both German and American abstraction. And then how do I kind of create space for myself to assist within this conversation? And I've always said this thing, I must then also too use the same tools. I do not want to make paintings out of paper. I do not want to make paintings out of rhetoric or conceptual ideas. But then I think everything, you know, conscious, unconsciously, or in, you know, devoted to the spirits, you know, has come at the right moment in which not only do I have a better understanding of what these paintings are, but they have come to live and come to manifest themselves in these galleries, you know, in a moment where there is a kind of, I don't think the word is confidence, but there is an awareness of itself. Mm-hmm. And I think that's almost the, if in terms of politics or the political, then it doesn't get more political than this. Because I am not trying to hide, or I am not trying to, you know, also, you know, being educated in Europe. So it's like, you know, I want to have that conversation, you know, again, using the same tools, you know, like I think that's kind of really, in a way, it boils down to that.
Yeah. Well, I feel like that's an amazing place to see if we have any questions, and maybe spend a few minutes taking a couple of those,
yeah,
if absolutely. You're open for it.
Yeah, absolutely.
We do have questions. I don't think we're going to be able to get to all of them today, but someone has asked, can you explain how the Midwest and St. Louis fits into your show and the work done locally with frequencies?
Yeah, it's a great question. I think that could be almost like another like hour easily. No, I think St. Louis, you know, historically the Midwest, and I don't want to be in a way provocative, but the history of this country in the last 10 years, you know, speaks of the importance of the Midwest in relation to politics, in relation to identity, in relation to race. But then if you extend that to the history literally of modernity, or like the industrial importance of this region, that why in if we were to say that the Midwest is kind of forgotten, or that is in the middle of nowhere, that it's in relation to New York, in relation to, you know, the other coast, LA, that is, you know, as Hannah just, you know, informed me, it's 5 hours away from Chicago. If you drive, if you fly, it's 40 minutes. That then, you know, that the importance of the river, that then you begin to understand that historically, this region was the epicenter of the United States, and that therefore it becomes obvious as to why you would have such a incredible, you know, if civilization or civilized societies must have a cultural institution, then the St. Louis Art Museum makes complete sense from a historical perspective and even contemporary. So then I think that becomes for me a tremendous, you would say, place to make an intervention or to kind of come and intervene with my kind of own baggage, not to make a judgment at all, but to make an intervention. Frequencies is a project of the world. You know, we are in an encyclopedic museum. And so when you insert a canvas done by a child in Mumbai or by a child in Johannesburg or a child in Singapore or Tokyo, Colombia, so on and so forth, you're immediately connecting this institution and all its history and all its baggage, not just the museum, but also a gesture in relation to history. So perhaps in contemporary terms, but also perhaps in the digital age, we might not see those connections firsthand, but you know, we cannot undermine or cannot take for granted the historical importance of a place like St. Louis, the Midwest, and how still in the context of politics has been, at least as a kind of reference, important in relation to the politics of this country, but also how the politics of this country affects societies beyond. So in a way, that small intervention, it's loaded with all these different layers that also do not have to be. Also, actually, when you walk into those galleries, it's just a beautiful juxtaposition to, you know, a canvas from a kid in Mumbai sitting amongst, you know, a room full of minimalism or minimalist sculpture that has, you know, 60 years of history, you know. So it's you know, I think it functions on multiple planes, perhaps.
Thank you so much, Hannah and Oscar.
This has been wonderful. I really hope that everyone is able to come to the show. It is definitely something that is you must see in person if you are able. And I think that's everything. So thank you both so much and have a great day, everyone.